So recently I was invited to give a talk at Fsec in Croatia, and I met some of you and that was awesome. During the conference there was also a CTF. I think all the challenges were actually created by Miroslav Stampar, the author of SQL Map. Also, let's try something new for this video. Let's see if we can mix challenge write-up and storytelling. Let me know if it sucks or if it makes it more fun to watch. Web 150, hard times. JavaScript plus form equal challenge. Let's have a look at it. So there's a simple form for a password and a button to check it. But when you enter anything, nothing happens. And when you open the developer tools, you immediately trigger a debugger breakpoint. It looks very similar to the anti-debugging mechanism of the pop-under stuff we had a look at. We can also go one up in the call stack and see that the JavaScript code is obfuscated. Those functions return the actual identifier, for example, debugger. By the way, it was my first time in Croatia and I really liked it. Fsec was held in Varaždin and the town was really pretty, and especially the building of the conference was this old theater. It was just a gorgeous location. Look at these rooms. Tony Mir, the main organizer, also wanted to take a picture of me. As much as I enjoy the conferences, I do need my alone time, and so I looked for a quiet place and worked on the challenge. As a next step, we can download the HTML and look at it locally. So the code is obviously not formatted. Actually, I spent quite some time making it pretty and defeating the anti-debugging statement. But I skip all of that because at some point I realized there's a much easier way. So for the form button, there's an onClick handler defined, the buttonClick function. So this chunk here is this function. So whatever we are looking for, it should be here. Let's beautify that part. So immediately you can find some functions that implement simple operations to obfuscate more of the code. This can be easily reversed. We can use the developer toolbar to evaluate those other functions for us. The debugger statement paused the script, but we can still use the console. So this first string, for example, was 32014. And this function down here results in the congratulations string. Then we have this big while loop with different cases inside. The switch case depends on G, and G comes from here. Let's check what this here stands for. This is the function split, and this was our first string from up there. So this just splits the string 32014. Okay, so we have a loop that executes these operations in a sequence. So it was just obfuscating the order a little bit. Case 0, 2, and 3 just initialize local variables with 0. We can also clean up case 1 a little bit in the same way we did before, just evaluate those functions with the developer console. And so this function is a for loop over the length of A, and A is the password input. So this loops over each character of our password. It sums up all the ASCII values in E, and XORs every value in F. Also, D is set based on some calculations of the char values. So this is definitely part of the password check. Some values are calculated based on the input string and probably later checked. Like I said, I was invited to Fsec to give a talk. I spoke about some CTF stuff. The talk got recorded, so I will share it once it's edited. I also used the opportunity during lightning talks and threw together a few slides to promote the streaming and video community. Sorry if I forgot somebody, I literally only had a few minutes to prepare. The main part of the challenge is this big if case here, so we should probably clean that one up next. It's a bit tedious but fairly straightforward. Just always look up what something evaluates to and make some notes or replace it. Let me fast forward that. So you can see how slowly the rules for the password check appear. And I also renamed the password charcode@ into pw with brackets because that's Python syntax and I'm more comfortable to read it. You know, the goal for me right now is not to have running JavaScript code, but just to understand the algorithm. And I want to get rid of anything that I find distracting so I can focus on what's important. Okay, cool. So first of all, you can see here E, F, and D compared to a constant. Those were calculated based on our input characters. Then we compare a lot of different characters in the password with each other. So for example, the first character ASCII value minus the second one has to be 4. And if all those cases are true, we have here an alert and everything is correct. Okay, that's it. We just have to find a password now that fits those conditions. Let's do an example. We just had this one case where the first character ASCII value minus the second character has to be 4. And the first check here with the regex makes sure that only those characters are allowed for the password. So we can quickly check all options we have. We just write two loops over the alphabet, subtract the ASCII value, and if it's 4, we print the 2. And it turns out there's only one valid case. So we already know our password must start with PL. We can also see that character at offset D and E have to be the same, or 2 and 8 and 7 and B. We also know that the character at position C has to be equal to the length shifted by 2. That could be useful to figure out what are valid lengths of the password. We can again write a loop, so the password can be 12, 17, 19 or 20 characters long, and depending on which length we use, we already know the value of the 12th character. When you keep doing that and lower the search space, you still end up with a huge amount of possible password combinations. And actually, the D variable is the hardest one to reverse in such a way. So you can write a brute force algorithm that takes these restrictions into account. You can really optimize that. But I didn't want to do that, and I was hoping I could use Z3 for that. Z3 or any other SAT solver are the go-to tools for problems like that. And a lot of challenges are really easy with it. So with Z3, you can just specify a few conditions and rules like we just found and then ask what input satisfies those rules. And then there are fancy algorithms that can solve such an equation system and provide possible inputs. But the larger the rules are, the longer it takes and might even become impossible to do in a short time. So for example, obviously you can't use it to reverse a SHA hash with it. And the D variable is such a condition which quickly explodes into a huge equation. Actually, the challenge author told me afterwards that he tried to make it such that it's infeasible to do with Z3 and that you have to create your own custom optimized brute force algorithm. But I thought I'd try a combination, mostly because I was lazy. So I thought I could let Z3 generate valid password that fulfill some conditions, at least the easy ones, and then brute force the difficult conditions like D. So here's my Z3 code. Let's jump right to the rules. As you can see, not much is different. The rules are like we saw them in JavaScript. But for example, the rule we looked at earlier with the first minus second character equal to 4, I remove because only one combination, PL, is valid. Thus, the rule is unnecessary and we can already make those fixed. Here I have a helper function that takes in a character and tells Z3 that the character has to be one of those values. And we apply that to each character of the password. The main function itself also takes in the length of the password and generates the Z3 bit vectors dynamically with this length. And at the bottom we have a typical Z3 snippet to check if it's even solvable, and then we generate some valid passwords. We print the password we found and also calculate D for it and check if it's what we expect. That's basically the brute force part, because Z3 can't easily solve that for us. And then we add the password we just found as a rule to not appear again, then Z3 will find another valid password that is not one of the previous ones. And we check again if it satisfies the D constant. So when we run it, we get a lot of valid passwords, but none fit D. But we can already see that the password could start with play. That would be a valid word, so we can take a guess and add more constraints, saying that the password has to start with play. And then it could be play underscore or playing, and so forth, and I just start playing around with this and see if I can generate meaningful valid passwords. And after a little bit, I've narrowed it down so much that actually one password is found that matches D. And this is the valid password, playing and losing. Also, Tonimir told me that I think some of his students asked if I'm playing the conference CTF and suspected me of hoarding flags because I was not winning. What? I thought they watch my videos and see how much I struggle. What the fuck, I'm not some CTF machine. I don't know how to solve all of these challenges either. I know a 10-minute video write-up looks impressive, but obviously it takes me hours when I actually look at it the first time. Though, I hope I make that clear in my videos. I really don't want to pretend I'm some kind of hacking god. You should check out the recent PopUnder livestream because there you can see how terrible and slow I really am. Just wanted to mention that. Anyway, thanks again for having me, Fsec. It was great, food was good, and hopefully we meet again another time.